This is one of the most important photographs ever taken in biology, but is also one of the most controversial. The data contained in this photograph eventually led to a Nobel Prize for the people who used it, but it was used without the knowledge or consent of those who took the photo. So what is it a photo of, how was it made, and who captured it? This video was originally posted to my second channel, but in the week of the 2024 Nobel Prize announcements, I thought I'd share it again for you here. In a way, this photo unlocks the secret of life, but really, the story of that discovery goes much further back, and the tale of people involved here is much more twisted than I thought it was. This isn't just a story of someone getting their photo stolen, it is a look at how credit is assigned in science, and who really gets the fame for making certain discoveries.
I thought, well, I brought the problem, so maybe my name really should be first, but...
This photo was made using a technique called X-ray crystallography. That means putting a crystal into a beam of X-rays, and the X-rays will interact with the electrons around the atoms in the crystal and create a diffraction pattern. Diffraction is when light spreads out, for example after passing through a slit, and it can create patterns on a wall that are like fingerprints pointing back at the shape of the molecule. But the patterns made by the diffracted rays are not immediately obvious. They're not the same shape as the molecule, and instead they're formed by the interaction of rays of light. Take, for example, the diffraction pattern you would get if you shined light through just a series of slits. You would get a line of dots. The bright spots are where the waves of light have constructively interfered with each other, and the dark spots are where the light waves have destructively interfered or cancelled each other out. If you then took a second set of slits and put it behind the first set and shined the light through that, then each one of those bright spots created by the first set of slits will be diffracted out into its own set of dots going in the other direction. But if the sets of slits were at an angle to each other, you would end up with a cross of dots. That is what we're seeing in this famous photograph. We're seeing a cross of dots that were created through the process of diffraction. So we can deduce that the crystal we were looking at might have two sets of slits held at an angle to each other. And in a weird kind of way, that's exactly what we had. The crystal in this case was something that we don't normally think of as a crystal, but it was actually the DNA molecule. DNA can be made into a crystallized form and then strung out. And we are now familiar with the idea that DNA is made of this double helix structure, kind of like a spring. If you zoom in on that shape and imagine the front part of the helix as being one set of slits, and the back part of the helix as being another set of slits, but tilted at an angle to the first set, then you can see how that might manifest as a cross of dots in the diffraction pattern. Understanding it in detail is not too important here. It's enough to know that this cross of dots was indicative of a helical structure, but it also revealed other information about DNA, such as the radius of the helix and how tightly coiled it is, so the distance between repeating units. The person responsible for this photo was Rosalind Franklin. At the time, she was working at King's College in London, focusing on the structural study of DNA. The photo was called Photo 51 because it was the 51st diffraction photo taken in Franklin's lab, and it was by far the best photo in existence of the structure of DNA. It wasn't the first such photo, in fact multiple people had taken earlier photos that just weren't as good. One of them was this one here taken by Morris Wilkins. The reason that Franklin's photo was different to this one was because she had managed to isolate just one form of the DNA crystal. Turns out that crystalline forms of DNA come in two types, structure A and structure B. Structure B, you could say, is more wet in the sense that it has mixed with more water and is actually the form that DNA would be in the cell. Structure A is kind of a dried up, more condensed or more crystallized version without that wetness. Wilkins' picture was a mixture of the two types, which is why you can't see one clear structure. The famous photo taken by Franklin is of the B structure. Her ability to isolate that one structure of DNA is why her image is so powerful at being able to deduce really precise measurements for the DNA molecule, and is what made this work groundbreaking. If you've heard about Rosalind Franklin before, you might have heard about her as someone who had her work stolen and was left out of getting credit for discovering the structure of DNA. And that comes from the fact that a Nobel Prize was given out for the work of figuring out the structure of DNA, but it didn't go to Rosalind Franklin. It went to three people: Watson, Crick, and Wilkins. So let's briefly recap how we went from having this photo taken in Franklin's lab to having a Nobel Prize for three other people. Franklin shared a lab with Morris Wilkins, and they kind of shared a PhD student too, but we'll get to him later. Wilkins had access to photograph 51 and a lot of Rosalind's notes too. One day, Wilkins received a visit from James Watson. Watson didn't get along with Franklin, and in fact, it's said that they had an argument on this fateful day. Franklin wouldn't share her work with Watson, but behind her back, Wilkins did share Franklin's work. He showed photograph 51 to Watson, and this did lead to Watson and his collaborator Crick being invigorated with what they needed as the final puzzle piece to figure out and describe the structure of DNA. It wasn't just the photograph of Franklin's that they had. There are three ways that Franklin's data made its way to Watson and Crick. She'd also given a seminar in 1951 that was attended by Watson. And in that seminar, she described DNA as being a big helix with several chains and with phosphates on the outside. She'd also written a research progress report that was a condition of her receiving funding from the Medical Research Council. Since Watson and Crick were also supported by the same research council, they had access to this progress report and found some more information of hers in there. Watson later wrote a book called The Double Helix, all about his discovery, but in that he writes many incriminating things about the way that he obtained Franklin's data. In one quote, he says that she, of course, did not directly give us her data. For that matter, no one at King's realized they were in our hands. And at another time said that Wilkins should never have shown me the thing. I didn't go into a drawer and steal it. It was shown to me, and I was told the dimensions. He says that the Franklin photograph was the key event, and that psychologically it mobilized them. But it's not true that Rosalind Franklin was completely left out of this narrative. So let's go one step deeper and take a look at this. This is the original paper from Watson and Crick, published in the journal Nature in 1953, where they detail their newly worked out structure of DNA, which turned out to be pretty much correct, and is what they ultimately won a Nobel Prize for. This paper was a huge moment for science, so let's take a look at it. It says that the structure of DNA has novel features which are of considerable biological interest. They talk about how they have a double helix shape, with phosphates on the outside and bases made of adenine, thymine, guanine, and cytosine, like rungs of a ladder, on the inside. They mention that only specific pairs of bases can bond together, and that this structure suggests a possible copying mechanism for the genetic material. They do actually mention Franklin's name in this paper. It is down here in the acknowledgement section. They say, "We have also been stimulated by a knowledge of the general nature of unpublished experimental results and ideas by Wilkins, Franklin, and their co-workers at King's College." But just over a paragraph earlier, they wrote what is pretty much a lie when they say they were not aware of the details of Franklin's work when they devised their structure. They say their work rests mainly, though not entirely, on published experimental data and stereochemical arguments. This was a lie because it would later become clear that they did definitely have access to Franklin's work and had actually used it to inform their model. But what's interesting is if I flick over one page here, and we find that in this same copy of Nature, three papers were actually published back to back. The first was the one I showed you from Watson and Crick, but the second is one from Wilkins, Stokes, and Wilson that presents the work they've done on this same topic and the best image that they have. And if we flick over one more page, we find a third paper, this one published by Franklin and her PhD student Raymond Gosling. This paper shows photograph 51 and all of the measurements that Franklin and Gosling had obtained from it. It talks about how DNA is a helical structure, that it repeats in a period every 34 angstroms, and that the radius of the helix is 10 angstroms. They deduce that the phosphate groups are on the outside. Looking at the density of the bases on the inside, they actually say that maybe there are two molecules in the helix. Their paper here was used as corroborating evidence that the Watson and Crick paper was consistent with experimental results, but of course it is, since it was actually based secretly on this experimental data.
4 years later, we got the Nobel Prize.
Watson, Crick, and Wilkins shared the Nobel Prize in 1962.
By then, Roslin was living in.
But tragically, Franklin had died before then. At the time, it was actually possible to award Nobel Prizes to people who had died, but the committee chose not to give it to her. Watson himself seems to have been on a bit of a campaign to disparage Franklin and her work, making a lot of disparaging comments about her in his books and his talks, and even some videos here on YouTube, since Watson is the last one still alive from this group. But this is not a story about Franklin missing out on the credit she deserved, because actually there are many, many characters in this story who also played a really important part. I made a brief mention earlier that Wilkins and Franklin kind of shared a PhD student, Raymond Gosling. Well, Gosling was actually the one who took photo 51 when he was working under Franklin's supervision. He co-authored that paper with Franklin, analyzing the image. And so he also deserves to be remembered as part of this story, but it doesn't stop with him. One might be mistaken for thinking that Watson, Crick, and Wilkins discovered DNA, but that's far from true. All they did was to be the ones to finally wrap up all of the work that it had been done by others into one package that made sense. DNA had been first isolated a very long time ago, in 1869. By a Swiss man called Maischer, who called it nuclein because he found it in the nucleus of cells. Another big leap was by Frederick Griffith in 1928, who did experiments that suggested that DNA carried genetic information. The very first X-ray diffraction patterns that showed DNA having a structure were produced in 1937 by William Astbury. And in 1943, Erwin Chargaff performed experiments that showed that the amount of guanine was always equal to the amount of cytosine, and the amount of adenine was always equal to the amount of thymine. That was a piece of work really important to understanding the base pairing and what was going on the inner rungs of DNA. And it was a crucial clue to figuring out this self-replicating ability of DNA. And it's not like Chargaff didn't realize the significance of his work. After the Nobel Prize was awarded to Watson, Crick, and Wilkins, Chargaff actually resigned from his lab and devoted the rest of his life seemingly to being upset about his exclusion from the Nobel Prize and from the credit of the discovery. He knew that his work had informed what ultimately won the prize, and he really turned on biochemistry and ideas of DNA technologies after this. A few other unknown PhD students by the names of Baton, Furberg, and Kreef also had parts of this puzzle figured out. There is in fact too many people who contributed to the final structure of DNA as we know it today to even mention in this video, and here are some of their names. If we look again at that famous paper from Watson and Crick, the one that gave them the Nobel Prize and a life of fame, well, we see that it's only one page long. And that's because they didn't actually present any of their own experimental data. In fact, they had no experiments and they had no data. They for sure did do work, and collating all the ideas that came before them and making them fit together in a way that chemically made sense and was physically possible, that was still an achievement, and they deserve to be recognized for that. But it's interesting to see that perhaps the most valued and important part of assigning credit in this case is to the people who had that skill of bringing it together. And without their own experimental data, it does show how heavily they were leaning on people like Franklin to be the shoulders upon which they would stand. By the time of the Watson and Crick paper, Rosalind Franklin had actually already moved on. She'd wrapped up her work on DNA and left the lab at King's College. She actually went on to work on RNA and viruses. She was one of the scientists to show that RNA was a single strand, and in that case, her co-workers, Finch and Klug, got the Nobel Prize again after her death. Given that many science breakthroughs do evolve over time like this through little bits done in various labs around the world, it would probably make sense if awards like the Nobel Prize or even funding models were able to recognize larger groups of people for their collaborations. By limiting it to just a few individuals who can take credit for such a big thing, it inevitably does lead to competition and resentment and secrecy. Something else I find interesting about this story is that it kind of went down around 1953. That's when these three major papers were published. And if you think about it, that's not very long ago. I think all students now would learn about the structure of DNA at school like it's obvious, like it's something we've always known, because it's such an important part of understanding life and understanding sort of how we came to be. But there are plenty of people not very long ago who didn't learn that at school because we didn't know it yet. And it makes you wonder what these next discoveries are going to be. In one generation from now, what will students learn at school that they'll think are obvious, but that we have no idea about? Some of the data to make that discovery has probably already been found, and is just waiting for the right people to put it together, or for time to play its part in shuffling ideas in the right way. Thanks for watching this video, and thanks to my Patreon supporters for making all of my videos possible. Since this video is a repost, I've included my own cat Lemon as the featured cat of the day, but if you want to see your own cat take that place in future videos, please support me and the channel by signing up to my Patreon. Thank you.